This morning, I want to talk to you about what's in a name. Really, what's in the name or a name. I started thinking about this as we were preparing for baby dedication, and I saw all these names of these little ones. I mean, like Sunshine, what a name. You know, I mean, that just makes you happy, right? You know, and everybody's name has a meaning. Have you ever, like, looked up the meaning to your name to find out if your parents really thought about it? Like, okay, this is a cool name. This is a good name. I'm going to give it to them, right? Or was there meaning? So my full name is Charles Joseph McCutcheon. That's a strong name, right? So Charles, I've done the look. Charles means strong and manly. Well, my parents got it right. Yeah, right? Woo! Ain't that right? Yeah. Nah, just kidding. Okay, well, maybe. At least in my mind, maybe they got it right. Okay? My wife hasn't heard me preach in here the last few times she's here today, and she's like, oh my gosh, he has already started out that way. Right? Joseph means God will give. Ooh. He has and continues to. Mom, you got it right. I'm not so sure about the strong and manly part, but hey, I'll claim it for me. But God will give is Joseph. And I started thinking about names. I started thinking about names. Started thinking about our kids' names. I have four children. I have Kensington Nicole. I have Charlie Grace. I have Riley Joy. And I have Landon Isaac. I have to think about that because I had a different middle name picked out for Landon. I did. I will tell you all a story, okay? So I remember when my brother started having kids before Bethany and I were, I think we're even married. We were, I can't remember which kid. It may have been Judah. I'll never forget sitting in a waiting room. And my brother, his first three kids have cool biblical names. And I remember my mom sitting in the waiting room, and we were waiting for, I think Judah was about to be born. And mom looked at Bethany and I, who we weren't even, I don't even know if we were engaged at the time. She's like, have y'all thought about your baby names? Which is a little odd. Were we engaged at that point? Was it Gideon? Okay, so we may have been married. And I'm like, yeah, we've thought about it. You know, we're getting through all this stuff. And yeah, you're right, it was Gideon. So mom, you didn't throw us quite to the wolves. But she starts asking, and she said, have you thought about names? And we're like, yeah. She said, oh, are you going to do the Bible names? No. I remember she's like, really? I'm like, yes, and that's okay. Because every name has meaning, right? So I started to think about it. And then when we got to having kids, we were pregnant with Riley. And Bethany had a list on her phone of different names for Riley. And we were sitting in Taco Bell St. Albans. And we're talking to Kenzie and Charlie about her name. And we had decided Riley was the first name, but we just couldn't land on a middle name. So Bethany starts talking to the girls about it. And Charlie goes, how about Riley Joy? And the next thing I know, Bethany's in tears, and she's opening her phone through this list of names that she's kind of got. And the only middle name she had was beside only one first name. And it was Riley Joy. And at that moment, we knew our little girl's name. She's always been Riley Joy since then. It was Riley Joy, okay? So fast forward to about a year later, we're pregnant with Landon. And I felt like the Lord had told me when we found out we were pregnant with Charlie, I thought we were having a boy then. Surprise, right? Surprise. You should have seen me when they were like, you're having a boy or having a girl. I'm like, you need to check that again. Lord told me we were having a boy. He even gave me a name. He gave me the name Isaiah. I was sitting in the balcony and in a service, and the prophetic broke loose. And this little boy came from his parents. He was sitting down here, came up and around and found me. And he said, hey, Pastor Joey, look at this truck. I will never forget it. Look at this truck. And I'm like, that's an awesome truck, little man. That's a great truck. He runs back down. Don't know if I've even talked to this kid since then. Okay? So I get in the car, and I'm like, Isaiah's his name. Bethany's like, I don't like that name. I said, I don't care. Lord told me. You know? Lord told me. Lord told me it was Isaiah. we're having a boy and it's Isaiah. She's like, Joey, I don't like that name. That's not, I don't feel it. And I'm like, I don't care. Thus saith the Lord. I'm pulling a trump card. Right? Thus saith the Lord. You know, she said, I just don't feel it. Well, then we find out it's a girl. And I'm like, thus saith the Lord. What did I miss? I'm not upset that I'm having a girl. I'm upset that I have missed the name. I'm upset that Isaiah is a cool name, not for a girl. You know, just doesn't work. And I know we got unique people doing unique things with names. Okay, so, but I'm like, okay. So when we found out we were pregnant with Landon, I'm like, Isaiah. Bethany looks at me and said, what if the spirit in the prophetic of Isaiah is supposed to be on Charlie, but it's never been her name? And you're trying to force that name on a son, but the identity of that name is actually in Charlie. And I'm like, Isaiah. Landon Isaiah. I mean, I am adamant. Isaiah. We're standing in our house. Here comes Charlie. You know, Bethany has told me maybe she operates in the prophetic like Isaiah and all this stuff. So Charlie, we're talking about it. And Charlie, I'll never forget, I'm standing in my kitchen. And I'm getting ready to come around the corner into the living room. And she said, what about Landon Isaac? And I kid you not, I almost went into the floor. And I looked at Bethany and I said, daggone it. Isaac's his name. That's really how it happened. So now we have Landon Isaac. So names are important. Names are important. I challenge you, go home, not right now, don't get out your phone and Google search it, but go home, do a little thing, find out, did your parents get it right like mine did, right? So I started thinking about these names in the Bible, and they were so important that sometimes God even changed names. In Genesis 17, Abram went to Abraham, Sarai or Sarai went to Sarah, and really what they did, they went from barren in old age to parents of nations. The name changed, but the identity that went along with it changed. We have, that was in Genesis 17. In Genesis 32, Jacob went to Israel. He went to, from struggled with God and humans, but has overcome. Jacob was a struggler. Israel was the overcomer. Simon to Peter, you know, one of the disciples, the crazy disciple that'll cut your ear off kind of person, right? Simon means he has heard or to listen. Not so sure Peter got that. Right? He said, you are Simon, son of Jonah. You will be called Cephas, which is translated Peter. This is in John 1, 42. And I don't think Peter got a hold of what that meant until later when he said, you, Simon Bar-Jonah, Peter, who do you say I am? And Peter went from this crazy guy to the one that would be, the church would be built on his revelation. Peter became this guy. He became the foundation. His prophetic word became the foundation of the church. And it happened under Peter, not Simon. So, the biggest one, that probably the one that we all know, is Paul to Saul. Or Saul to Paul, right? Persecutor to apostle. Like, you don't get much more radical in that than that. Right, I mean, like, his name changed, his demeanor changed, and all of a sudden he went from killing the church to leading the church. And I'm like, holy cow. But then I started to think about this one name. Those names are good, but those names don't save. I love Abraham, and I love what God did and how he raised up nations and did things. I love how a sinner can look at the life of Saul and Paul and think, how could I get any, how could God save me? This is a guy who went from killing people to leading the church and writing most of the New Testament. So if you feel like you're a sinner and you're too far gone, just look at the life of the Apostle Paul. But as good as the life of the Apostle Paul is, as good as the stories of these guys are, there is still one name that ranks far above every name. There is still one name that supersedes all of these. And his name is Jesus. And we can shout. We can do what we want. Listen, I've been in church all my life. We've been singing songs about the name of Jesus for as long as I have been alive and far beyond that. But we have not operated in the power that is given to us in his name. We just haven't done it. Acts 4:12 says, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we can be saved, or by which we must be saved. There's only one name. So I started to think about this scripture, and we get hung up on the word saved because we think saved has to be sinner to salvation, right? That's how we picture saved. But I can be a Christian walking with God and still need saving from something. And I will call anybody and everybody to help me out of a situation, but the last thing I want to do is just say, Jesus. But salvation comes through his name to whatever situation we find ourselves in. And we don't operate in the authority that we've been given to just say his name. Have you ever walked into... I've talked a lot about my mom today, but I was thinking about this morning. 15 or so years ago when I moved to Enterprise, a few weeks before I moved, Bethany and my mom came up, and I had rented this little two-bedroom apartment in this like really old building, but it was $250 a month rent. I'd love to go back to $250 a month, right? I'm like, please, Jesus, that'd be awesome, right? So, but we had to go in and do some cleaning because it hadn't been used for a while and all this stuff. So we went and did some cleaning, and pastor's like, I have this favorite Mexican restaurant that I want to take you to. So Ted and Suzette had graciously let us borrow their SUV. I think it was an Explorer, that green Explorer. They let us load it and bring some of my stuff up that weekend. So we decided there was a snowstorm. And listen, 2 hours north, snow is different than Charleston. I didn't understand that till I lived there. It really is different. It's crazy. But we all get in the car and we give Pastor the keys. Because there's one thing I've learned. Now, there's times that he'll say, Joey, you drive. I'd rather him drive. I don't care to ride along, but I'd just rather him drive, you know? So we get in the car, and we don't know where we're going, so we're like, here's the key. So he gets in the driver's seat. My mom gets motion sick, so she's in the passenger seat. Miss Tam, Bethany, and I, we're all towards the back. And we go to eat, and somewhere between getting to the restaurant and leaving the restaurant, a snowstorm has hit. Well, praise the Lord, pastor's got the keys. We're in a four-wheel drive SUV. You know, you're thinking, I got it. So we're leaving Fairmont, and the way out went down this little road to a bigger road, T. We're driving, and you can see a car coming in the distance, and we're going to have to get stopped. So pastor taps the brakes. Doesn't stop. Does not stop. And he, you know, pastor being man of God, he's cool, you know, just ride it out. Me in the back, I'm like, ooh, my mom is a closet intercessor. She is. I love it. Listen, I used to wake up every morning and hear my mom crying out for her family. My mom is an intercessor, but you don't see it in action very often, but when she needs it, she knows how to use it, and she knows there's authority in it. So immediately, she didn't care that he was a senior pastor over here. She didn't care that there was people she didn't really know in the back. I mean, my mom hadn't really talked to pastor except for a few times, and my mom's very quiet. Okay, but all of a sudden, what's in my mom comes out, and she throws out her arms up, and she just starts going, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Hey, listen, we can laugh about that, but I'll have you know that Jesus took the wheel, and we weren't in a wreck. There was power released in a name. We didn't need to come to an altar and say, Lord, forgive me of my sins. We were all saved, loving Jesus, but we found ourselves in need of a saving right there. And the only thing my mom knew to do was Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. She released something in the air. And you may say, well, Pastor Joey, that's nuts. You may think that. All I know is we were heading for a disaster, disaster averted on one name, and his name was Jesus. That's what I know, right? So I started to think about this. It said no name. So we get into this. And then Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. You can turn there if you want. I think it'll be on the screen. The prophet Isaiah, see, here we go back to this prophet, right? We go back to Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. He says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Can I get an amen on the Prince of Peace? "Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end upon his throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform." And we get stuck in the name being salvation only, sinner to saved. But there was so much more in Jesus, the name that was given. It was so important that when Mary became pregnant, the angel went to Mary in Luke 1:31. He said, "And behold, you'll conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." So it's not just, hey, you're having a son. It's, this will be his name. Okay? Then the angel, to make sure, because fathers established the name. Fathers were the ones who made the declaration. So he had to make sure not only did Mary know, but that Joseph knew. So in Matthew 1:21, angel goes to Joseph and says, Mary will give birth to a son, and you, Joseph, are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. So doing what Joseph was supposed to do as the spirit, as the earthly father, he 8 days in Luke 2:21, when the 8 days until his circumcision had passed, he was named Jesus. The name the angel had given him before he had even been conceived. Think about that. That name that we don't use effectively was so important that men were prophesying about it hundreds of years beforehand, that the angel made sure that both parents, not just one, that both parents were in agreement and knew the word of the Lord said, "You shall call him Jesus, because he came to save his people." And yet the last thing we want to do when there is something that we need help with or saving from is to actually use his name, Jesus. Now, I did not go to the West Virginia State Boys Basketball Tournament. Congrats to all you polka dots. It was a good day for polka. Yeah, they won. It's a good day for Putnam County. We had show choir champions and basketball champions in Putnam County. But this is what I know. I guarantee his name was used multiple times at players, coaches, referees, and anybody in between when talking about the game. See, we always say we took his name in vain. I think part of the reason we take his name in vain is when we take his name and don't use it effectively. You know, we want to say, well, they said the name of Jesus in vain. Well, so did you, because you ain't using it with the power that it's been given to you. You take it for granted, but you don't recognize the power that you've been given through his name. What would the world look like if you really walked out of here going, "In Jesus' name," and meant what you said? Because the world one day will be subject to his name. They can deny it all they want. They can say Allah, Buddha. What I was watching a TV show yesterday, and some crazy woman went, "Thanks, Buddha." I mean, seriously, I'm watching a cooking show. There's a cooking show called Next Level Chef. And for the most part, it's clean. It's one of the cleanest shows on TV. Okay? Which is hard to find nowadays. But as this table moves up and down, you've only got 30 seconds to pull random ingredients off of to make your dish to compete against the other characters. So she, or characters, contestants, sometimes they're characters, who knows, right? She grabbed, I can't even remember what she grabbed, but she's like, thanks, Buddha. I'm like, are you kidding me? That may be the dumbest thing I've heard in a long time. When's the last time that fat little dude sitting on a countertop did anything? Guess what? Never. And we have a world that tries to equate Buddha, Allah, Muhammad to Jesus, and it isn't happening. I don't care what world tells you that they're the same, they're just different. They are not the same. There is, if Muhammad was Jesus, he'd be Jesus. If Buddha was Jesus, he'd be Jesus. There is no name given under heaven to man that is Jesus. Period. Can we just get that right? But I mean, seriously, I mean, Bethany looked at me and she said, you have got to be kidding me. I'm like, that, honestly, it's like Comedy Central over here. Like, do you really, like, oh, thanks, Buddha. Like, seriously? I couldn't believe it. But that's the world we live in. We want to start changing his name to fit. What, you know, we don't want to offend this one. So Allah and Buddha are, or Allah and Jesus are the same. Quit making my Jesus less than to appease someone else. Because I'm sorry, when Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, he was saying, when someone comes against you in the name of something else, you look at him and say, Jesus is. You can think you can get there some other way, but Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. See, there's power in his name, y'all. And we are ineffective in using it. We come in and we're like, we'll sing wonderful songs. Listen, y'all, I told y'all, I grew up in church. So I started thinking about it. The Lord speaks to me through songs, okay? That shouldn't surprise y'all. So you want an old hymn about his name? Jesus. Jesus, there's just something about that name. See, we sing about it. Oh, you want the gospel version? There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. Yeah, you love to sing it, but you don't use it. Oh, we'll sing. Oh, you want the contemporary. What a beautiful name it is. Oh, you even get to that last verse. What a powerful name it is. But you using it like a squirt gun. It's powerful. It's powerful. Jesus. I'm serious. Like, listen, I know we can laugh and have a good time in church, but I'm serious. We want to come in and we want to sing songs about it, but when it comes time to use it, we have not one idea the power that it carries. When's the last time you truly came up to an altar with someone who was so lost and so down and so out that you want, and with all authority that's been given to you in Jesus' name, really laid hands and really believed? Because that power is on the inside of you. You want to know why you've not seen the dead raised? Because we go in and we say, we'll do it from a distance. We'll do it from a distance, but we don't want to walk in a morgue and lay hands on a dead person and say, in Jesus' name, get up, because we don't want egg on our face if it doesn't happen. But if I'm not saying go out of here, walk into a morgue and say, I'm going to lay hands on somebody. But I remember several years ago when the Lord prompted a woman to go, and she looked at me. I didn't have that leading, and I offended her because I'm like, I believe, but help thou my unbelief. I don't have that. I don't have that petition. And she looked at us and said, if I die young, not bury me in satin and lay me down on a bed of roses. She said, if I die prematurely, you better go to a morgue and lay hands on me and in Jesus' name give it everything you got. Not 2 years later, on a Wednesday evening, she dropped her kids off in our youth ministry, went for a bike ride. She was a motorcyclist. And about 3 miles, 4 miles from the church, somebody rear-ended the car in the other lane, and the wheels were already turned, so it pushed them into her path, severed a femoral artery. She was dead before she ever came to rest on the pavement. And I will never forget calling Bobby Limley because he was the only one I knew crazy enough to coach me on how to do this. I'm serious. I thought, who's crazy enough to know how to get to a morgue? Call Bobby. And I knew it was time, because I got word after service that we're going to be coming to talk to her kids. I mean, I had her teenage children. Mom went on a motorcycle ride, and before church was out, mom's in eternity. So church is out. We have to break the news to her kids. And I'm thinking, I'm going to call Bobby Limley. Because if I know anybody who's probably already done this multiple times, it was Bobby. So I called Bobby. I said, bro, you're going to have to pray for us. I don't know if Bethany remembers that conversation. We're driving out Saltwell Road. I'm like, Jesus, what do I even say? And I got there and found out that my pastor and his wife and one of our intercessors was already in praying fire down in the morgue. So I thought, well, okay, I was prepared. I don't have to because, you know, pastor's already got it covered. It didn't happen, but I guarantee pastor walked in. I mean, that time when that woman died, I felt like, okay, I have some authority in it now. I don't feel the same way. Yeah, I was nervous, but I was more nervous of what people would say. Not that I could actually do it. I wasn't nervous if I could do it because there was an unction on the inside of me. Maybe it was because she had told me, if I die young, you better go pray. But there was something on the inside of me that I thought, as scared as I am, I'm doing what this woman has asked. In Jesus' name, not by me, not by my might, not by my power, but by His Spirit in Jesus' name, I will. I can. He's given it to me. A few days later, we buried her. And a lot of times because we've prayed and we've spoken Jesus into situations that we don't see, we want to stop using His name. Why would I pray for someone to be healed of cancer when the last time I prayed didn't happen? Oh, but it did. Just not the way you thought. Do you know what the enemy was whispering to me as I laid hands on children today? You prayed to me for a daughter to be healed. What'd that get you? In Jesus' name. He knew what I was preaching. And don't think he didn't echo it every time I laid hands on a young person up here. But I pray that one day, if I'm put in that situation to lay hands on a mom who's got bad news and pray for the baby, not a fetus, not a bundle of tissue, but I pray for that child that's created in the image of God, and that I pray that the syndrome that they've said is going to take your daughter's life is turned upside down, corrected in Jesus' name. And just because I don't see it manifested the way I want it doesn't take away from the power of it. See, we pray one time in Jesus' name, it doesn't happen, and all of a sudden we think the power has diminished. That we're going to have to figure out a way to recharge. It's like rechargeable batteries. I'm going to have to go back. I can't use this mic anymore. The battery's dead. I can't use this Jesus right now. He wasn't up to the task. There wasn't enough power in that name. But that's not what the Word says. Let me get to my scripture. I'm sorry. Demons, listen, here's how much power is in it. In Mark 16, 17, and 18, and these signs will follow them who believe. In my name, cast out demons, speak with new tongues, take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, they will recover. What am I saying? Just speak Jesus into your situation today. Sometimes you get in it, and maybe it doesn't change the whole situation immediately, but just saying His name will change your perspective on it. You ever got into something and you just begin to remind yourself who Jesus is? Maybe you need to go into your your closet, your prayer room, your quiet space, whatever that is, and just begin, because the enemy has come in and said, you've called him a healer, but where's the healing? You've called him provision, but your bank account has less than it used to. You've asked him to restore your marriage, and you're heading to divorce, and you know, you're asking for restoration. See, the enemy will remind you of what you're going through, and what I'm telling you today is go in. You don't have to think of anything except Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I started to think about this. I started to, over the past few weeks, there's a song, it's been out for quite a while, Waymaker, Miracle Worker, Promise Keeper. And it's just a reminder of who he is. But I stumbled on this group. Some of y'all know, Pentecostals of Alexandria. I mean, I love watching them. I mean, hair up in a bun. And they got, John, they've got Janelle's twin sister playing the drums. Like, seriously, my brother introduced me to him, and he's like, we grew up with the Gadullas, so we know Janelle. And he's like, Joey, they've got a Janelle twin. I mean, dressed to the floor. She's back there beating the snot out of those drums. Man, it's awesome. Right? But this woman begins to sing. And as she gets out of the second verse of You Are Here, Moving in Our Midst, she's making this declaration. At the end of the second verse, and I'm going to be honest with you, I love women worship leaders, but there's very few that really just have this grit authority where you're like, she could take my head off, right? I mean, that's just where she's at. And I'm not down on women worship leaders, but we're all gifted and called, even men worship leaders, for different things. Some sing slow songs. Some things sings declarative songs. Some sing high praise, whatever. It doesn't matter. But this woman, as she comes out of that second verse and gets ready to go into Waymaker, her ad lib to get me ready. I feel like I didn't play sports. I've told y'all that. I'm terrible. I'm not an athlete. I could only dream of what it would have felt like to be Poca High School yesterday on a basketball court. Because in seventh grade, I tried out. I'm terrible, and I got cut, and I've never done it again. Okay? But y'all remember jock jams? Bum, bum, bum. Ba-na, ba-na. You know, you hear it when you get young. Ba-na, 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 ba-na. Hey! Ba-na, ba-na, ba-na. You know, I can only imagine. Listen, I was the mascot. Where's Danny and Karen? Are they in here? Yeah. Karen's got pictures. Listen, my political career ended in seventh grade because I put on an Indian costume. Right? But Karen's got pictures. But I remember what it was like. And I remember standing in line with the football team. And I was coming in as the Redskin, you know, feeling like, yeah. And all these, you know, the strong and manly kids, the real Charleses of the group over here, they're like hitting their helmets on each other like, yeah, yeah. And they're coming through the line, 50, and here I am waving a banner, riding a horse. Strong and manly, right? So, okay. So listen, but I will never forget as the music played over the loudspeaker and that introduction came in, the authority. It didn't matter who our team was playing, if they were 15-point underdogs or 30-point, I don't even know if you're not an underdog, whatever. Yeah, huh? Favorite? Yeah. It didn't matter. That music started to play and they said, here come your Redskins. And oh, they came. And I remember they, woo! Woo! Yeah! So here I am watching this video of Waymaker. And this woman, as she gets ready to start declaring, her ad lib says, I want to take some time and call you. And I'm like, oh, hey. I'm in my house. I'm like, y'all don't know. I don't make a Baptist speak in tongues. Woo. Why? Because there was something when she says that line that she releases a declarative, a prophetic word about the power that's in his name. And sometimes what you need to do is go in and remind the devil, I'm just going to take some time and call him Waymaker, Miracle Worker, Promise Keeper, Light in the Darkness. And if you can't remember it, just say Jesus. You don't have to sit here with notes going, okay, Promise Keeper, Light in the Dark. What's the name of that song? What's that? Listen, if you walk out of here and you don't remember anything, Jesus is his name, and all power and all authority still is in his name. But we don't act like it. Yeah. I'm telling y'all, man. What would this valley look like if the 300 plus people that are in this room walked out of here, and when you went to dinner and you prayed over it and you just said, in Jesus' name, at the end of your prayer? You didn't even have to pray for someone. You could be blessing the food, but at the end of most prayers, we say, in Jesus' name. What are you releasing in that restaurant or in your home if you're just even at dinner time? In Jesus' name. What would it happen for the person who gets in your booth after you get up? They sit down and go, I don't know what happened, but there's something unique about this booth. And it's because a group of people decided when they prayed to really mean in Jesus' name. I mean, what would you do if you got on the news and it's like Dill's Restaurant breaks out in revival? No invitation given, no altar call. And you're like, oh, I just went in, had some open face roast beef. And as I prayed, I just said, in Jesus' name. And the person behind you sat down and was like, I don't know what this is, but there's something unique going on. What are you going to do? We have that power. But listen, as we begin to recognize and operate in it, you're going to stir it up. As Jesus crossed the sea and stepped off the boat and was met by a man with legion addressed him by name. Jesus, we know who you are. Yeah. And because the same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead is alive in you, if you operate in it, they're going to look and say, Josh Harvey, because of the Jesus alive in you, I know who you are. And they're going to be scared by it because Josh Harvey knows the power in his name. I say Josh because he's a school teacher. And if there's ever someone you want to speak the name into an atmosphere, it's in the public school system. Listen, I know what he's my daughter's PE coach, and I know what my daughter's come home talking about on the playground. I know what they're coming home. Listen, I want a man of God who will speak the name of Jesus into a dark atmosphere to change it. I'm not asking Josh to lay hands and pray for students. I'm asking Josh to take a stand, and when he's walking to his classroom, to say, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Why? Because I've seen it work when my mom called on it at a car. Well, you may think that's crazy. It would have just been a fender bender. Maybe. What if it had been worse? But my mom knew in that moment, Jesus, Jesus. Pastor and I still laugh about it. We do. We still giggle. He's like, man, I'll never forget. One of the first words, like I told you, my mom's quiet. She had been around pastor like two or three times and never uttered a word. But the first words that he remembers my mom saying was in a time when he wasn't in control. None of us were in control. But the name of Jesus got spoken. And all of a sudden, we may not have been in control, but he was in control and the situation worked out. My question to you today is, what's your situation? Pastor Andy, you can come up and play. See, we have to release. He wants to get involved, but you have to let him in. Oh, he can supersede you, and he can step in, and he can do. And he will at times do that, but sometimes he wants you to just say his name. With all power, with all authority that's been given to you. When someone walks up to you, ask for money, you're going to look at him like Peter and John and say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus. Man, what are they going to do with that? I was talking to Elmer a little bit about this on I think it was Friday. I was helping get kids' church set up, and Elmer was over there. And I was talking to him a little bit about the message, and he told me a story that he was walking through an alley one night many years ago. I think Elmer would tell you the date, time, location, right? I think it was in 1982. That's just who Elmer is. 1982, he was walking through. He normally went with a buddy. He wasn't trying to do anything wrong. I think he was even going to, like, minister, like, just to maybe even go visit shut-ins or something. And his partner couldn't go. So he was walking through, and these two guys came up to him, like, came running to him, and they said, "You got any money?" And, I mean, Elmer's like, in my mind, I'm going to die tonight. Here I am trying to do the work of the kingdom. I'm going to die tonight. And Elmer said, "I was a new convert. I didn't know much scripture, but I did remember one story." And he looked at them and said, "Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you, Jesus." I was like, I didn't know what else to do. So I thought, Peter and John, it worked for them. Maybe it'll work for me. "Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you, Jesus." He said immediately, they stood up and they said, "Hey, man, we're religious too." Like, seriously. He said, "I'm alive today because there was power in his name." Listen. Oh, there's something about his name, y'all. And oh, it's wonderful, and oh, it's beautiful. But there's untapped power because the church doesn't recognize the authority they've been given in his name. We'll come in and we'll sing beautiful songs about it. And I'm all about singing. I'm all about, y'all know me, worship is a part of who I am, and no matter what role I play in a church, worship will always be a part of who I am. And I'm all about singing about his name. But oh, I can't wait to see what happens when a body of blood-bought, sanctified, Holy Ghost-filled child of God, children of God, really begin to lay hands on situations beyond their control and say, "In Jesus' name." Now, I ain't telling you to go out and buy a lottery ticket and say, "In Jesus' name, I want this $10 million. No. Come on, it don't work like that. He ain't a genie in a bottle. But there's power. So if you'd stand to your feet this morning, if you don't know Jesus, maybe you're the one sitting here and you're like, "Salvation is really what I need. I'm a sinner." Today's your day. He's calling your name. He wants you. And if that's you, I'm going to ask you to come. You can find a place around the altar. One of our altar worker team members, they will come and pray with you. But this really is a call to the church to say, "I want to use his name correctly. I want to lay hands on the sick in Jesus' name and watch them recover. I want someone whose marriage is heading for divorce and you're praying for restoration, for you to come and really just speak Jesus in the name and watch God do a work. Don't think he can't do it. Maybe it's financial. Maybe you're dealing with something emotionally, mentally. Maybe it's a spiritual thing that's going on in your life. But you've ran and you've called and you've talked and you've asked and you've this and you've that. But the one person that you have failed to really just give authority to is Jesus. And today, all he wants you to do is speak his name and invite him in. So as we pray, these altars are open. You come find you a place. Jesus, we thank you for this day. And God, I thank you there's power in your name. That at the very mention of your name, Knees will bow and tongues will confess that you are Lord. At the mention of your name, that cancer has to flee, that sickness has to be gone, that COVID has to bow its knee, that AIDS has to bow its knee, that homosexuality has to be gone, that a drug addiction has to be gone, that financial situations have to be gone. If we speak the name of Jesus, Lord, we release it today. In Jesus' name, amen. As Pastor Andy sings, these altars are open.
Jesus.
It's not. Is it there? Okay. He's been good to his church. And my prayer has been all week that as we go about our day, that we just get his name in the atmosphere. It may not be for you, but it may be for someone who's going to follow in your footsteps. Walking down the hall at work, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Because you don't know what your coworkers have gone through. Atmospheres will change at his name. You don't have to have a worship set, a pastor. You, me, have power in his name. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for this day. God, I thank you for the power that's in your name. Lord, we honor you in this place. God, we don't take that name for granted. And forgive us if we've taken that name in vain. But God, we're asking you to help us to walk in the power that is given to us through your name. From this day forward, God, we give you praise, we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.